You have a very distinctive and strong cymbal beat. And I'm thinking about a couple of particular records that start out with you playing just the right cymbal. And, you know, there's that one record by Kenny Werner. I think it's called Unprotected Music. I think the first song starts out with you just playing a very dry cymbal. There's moments in Abercrombie's records with the quartet, which feature you just starting out with very strong, you know, ding 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 ding, you know, playing something like this. Also on These Rooms, I think second tune or something, you're playing a blues in G. It starts out with you playing. And it's, you know, you have a very recognizable sound, but also touch and, you know, feel. I was wondering how you worked on that.
Well, Tony Williams, he said in different interviews that he did that he would just play the ride cymbal for hours at a time. Nothing else, just playing the ride cymbal. Mm-hmm. And I have to say, that's great advice. It's really great advice. Sit in a room and just carve out some time and just play the ride cymbal and work on whatever you're working on, if you're working on fast tempos or if you're working on slow tempos, but just play it so you get to hear what the instrument puts out when you're constantly, it's a piece of metal that you're hitting rapidly, and it brings a lot of sound. And what are you going to do about that? You know, how do you navigate that? And also, there's a way where you just slug away and you don't listen and you get nothing, really, except you can, the next time you play, that's how you're going to play. Mm-hmm. You slug away. Or you go in and put your attention on what kind of sound you are making. That's the shit. Mm-hmm. You put your attention on it and keep doing it. And if your attention is on it, you'll realize, oh, wow, I'm playing. If there was a bass player in here, there's no way they could even be heard. If I'm working on the cymbal beat and I realize that, I'll keep playing and I'll gradually imagine what level the bass player would be playing at and what level I would have to, how much sound would I have to do away with in order for that bass player to have fun. Mm-hmm. So that they weren't having to go like that just to be heard in the ensemble.
True.
Or if the piano player is stuck with a spinet, a real piece of shit, what level would I have to play at so that they don't have to go like that to just to be heard? Because then they have no place to go. Mm. And just play time. That's how I work on it. I play tempos. Mm-hmm. If I really want to put myself on the heating block or whatever, I play a real slow tempo. And see, you know, that's hard. It's very hard to relax into it and keep the energy up, keep the intensity up.
How would you, if you're using the metronome, I suppose, or?
No. Don't use a metronome. Metronome is dead. Mm. To me, metronome is just a guide so that you can educate yourself as to what your tendency is.
What do you use?
My ears. You know, a metronome is good. I'm not saying don't ever use a metronome, but for this, I mean, you have to, at some point, playing along with records, the record is a metronome at some point, even though the tempos are fluctuating. Mm. It's a one-way conversation.
Yeah.
At a certain point, you've got to turn everything off, and you've got to do it. And that is where you play the cymbal and then record it for 5 minutes or so, and then turn it off and take a break or whatever, and go back and listen to it with the same scrutiny that you listen to everybody else that you criticize. The exact same scrutiny. That's where you progress. Or if you don't record it just pay attention to what you're doing, stop playing, and then listen to it in your mind. And then go back and do it again. It's where your attention is. That's the key. You don't have to spend hours and hours doing it, but whatever time you do spend, your attention needs to be focused. You could easily waste 4 hours playing, ding, 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 or ding, ding. You could easily spend 4 hours doing that and get nothing. So it's really a matter of that. That's how I work on focusing my attention. And then just playing the cymbal and listening to the instrument. What spot that I'm hitting creates more of a sound? What happens when I'm playing here? And then you're able to figure out, oh, if I hit on this area, it'll get more attack. Or if I hold the stick looser, it'll get more of a different sound that might be applicable to a certain situation. It's just information. You have to learn the instrument and learn what options are available.
Yeah.
And then you really learn them so that when you go play with somebody, or even when you go play, present music, even if it's a solo concert, you are familiar with whatever options there are. Because even playing alone, you have to listen. And what note in the voicing do you want to bring out? The middle note, the top note, or it's a lifelong study, I think. You saw that video of Glenn Gould, right?
Which one?
Him playing the Goldberg variations, him recording.
And then standing up. There's one where he stands up and sings the melody, standing next to a window. You know, you don't mean that one, or?
Well, no, all of them. They're all
okay,
the same type of thing. You know, it's that intense.
Yeah.
You know, on the level, to me, playing the ride cymbal, learning how to really play it, can be as intense as the way Glenn Gould, how he could just bring out certain voices.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that must be impossible.
Yeah. Know? Yeah.
But it's
pretty out there.
It's pretty out there, but it's worth, I tell you something, it's worth going for. Because when you get close, even when you get close, it makes such a difference. It just when you hear people that just don't have any attention for that stuff, the music's not as good.
Mm-hmm.
It really isn't.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's how I work on it. I work on it all the time. I mean, because I don't travel with cymbals. So every time I play, I need to very quickly know what my options are.
Yeah.
So the more work I do, the easier it is for me to approach a working situation and get straight to the music instead of being a prima donna about my cymbals and my drums and all that stuff.
Mm. I think you're kind of the front runner when it comes to that. Not bringing your own cymbals and having your own sound within you, as everybody does, of course, but nobody has the guts to, you know, to say, well, I'm not going to play my cymbals. I'm going to be inspired by whatever is there. And that way you're more like a piano player in a way, you know, because we have to deal with whatever is there.
Yeah.
And we all carry our sound in ourselves. And if we get, you know, caught up in criticizing everything that's in front of us, we're not in the moment, and also we lose the opportunity to play differently also.
Yeah.
I saw you play at the Stadtgarten, and I think instead of you had two cymbals, but one of them was, I think, the tiniest cymbal you could find in the Stadtgarten.
Down in the toilet, probably.
Yeah, I think so. So when you were trading fours, you were playing, you're playing your fours, and then going back to the small cymbal. It was so funny and great. I loved it, but I never heard you play like that before, you know. And it was you, and I thought that was a big lesson, you know.
Oh, thank you.
When did you start doing that?
Start doing what? Not traveling
with your cymbals.
was pretty soon after I got to New York in the 80s. I played electronics at a certain point. I had a big trap case full of electronics and Casio keyboard that I used, and pickups and delay pedals and stuff like that. I was using that stuff, and I would carry that around in a small cymbal bag, and I had all small cymbals. And I remember one morning, Paul Motion was with the Liberation Orchestra. We were all staying at the same hotel, and he used to get up really early, and he was just hanging out in front of the hotel, and the group I was with, we had to leave early, and I'm out. And I say, "Hey, Paul," I said, "are you all set to go?" And he said, "Yeah, man." And he's just swinging this cymbal bag. I said, "Where's all your stuff?" He says, "Right here, man." I said, "What do you mean?" He says, "This is it, man. I just take my ride cymbal." And he had that laugh, you know, that he always would laugh. Steve Cardenas can really imitate him really well. I can't do it. But, anyhow, that kind of got me thinking, wow, Paul only brings a ride cymbal. And then I thought, yeah. And shortly after that, I went through Amsterdam, and they destroyed all of my electronics and everything. So
no.
That was a very short. After that trip, I realized, you know what? I mean, for other reasons, for musical reasons too, it didn't really work with a drum set for me. There's too much of a delay in hearing a sound and pressing a pedal and then getting back to playing. That split second was too much for me. And I didn't want to carry electric drums and I didn't want to go the route of having my own sound tech, because, hey, the guys I was working with, we were lucky we had gigs. So, I just decided to shelve all of that and just really get into the drum and how to get what I'm hearing out of my instrument. And then at the same time, I was thinking, Paul, he only brings one cymbal. Well, shit. Why do I need to bring any?
Mm-hmm.
Just bring my sticks. And then I realized, yeah. Because, I mean, even years before that, when I was living in Los Angeles, before I even came to New York, my cymbals were stolen. And Peter Donald lent me a hi-hat, his hi-hat cymbals. And I didn't have anything. I had a gig the next night after they were stolen, and he loaned me his hi-hat cymbals. So what I did was I got a pan and put a hole in like a pie plate, metal pie plate, and used that on the bottom of the hi-hat. And then I attached one hi-hat cymbal as the top cymbal. And then I used the other one as my ride cymbal. And I just kept my mouth shut all night. Nobody said anything. Nobody knew the difference.
Yeah.
So that started me thinking about, well, it's not so much the instrument. It's how you're playing it and what you're playing. What is the information that I'm putting on a cymbal, and how am I doing it? How am I playing the cymbal? And I just thought, well, that's what I want to focus on. So I began to start to work on that, because I had to always do that.
Mm-hmm.
I played that little hi-hat cymbal, and I continued to do my little gigs and play with people until I could get some other cymbals. But that was kind of what started me thinking, it's not the instrument, it's the musician. And that's not to say I don't appreciate good instruments.
Sure. Who doesn't?
But in the practical world of being involved in playing creative music, these days you can't afford to bring your own instrument. Bass players can't even bring their instrument. It's not even a possible. It's not even a thought anymore.
Yeah.
I mean, it's horrible conditions, really. But we navigate them.
Mm-hmm. How's it on recordings? Sorry for interrupting, but
sometimes I use if I'm recording in New York, I'll use mine.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I'll use a combination of if I see something that's in the trash bin, or I call it, or the cymbal bin of a studio. I might pick it up. I might, if I like the sound, if it seems like it might be appropriate, I'll put that up. Or if I'm out of New York, many cases in a studio, I just use what they have. And a lot of times it's not very good, but okay, it's what's there. And I try, do my best to get as, you know, the best I can manage. But when it comes down to it, I've got to really play some music.
Yeah.
So I've kind of trained myself to work on things like touch. I think it's really important. I heard your interview with Larry Goldens, which was fantastic. Man, Larry's fantastic, isn't he?
Yeah, sure. And thanks for checking it out.
Yeah. You guys were talking about sound reproduction. I mean, that's something that people don't really think about. Everybody follows the flavor of the month and they tune their drums the same way.
Yeah.
Well, no, it's not it.
Yeah.
all the guys that I stand on, that whose shoulders I stand on, they all had a real personal sound that you could hear no matter what instrument they were playing. Piano players, horn players, drummers, and whatever instrument they themselves were playing, and it sounded like it was their instrument. It's kind of cool for me because I can bypass all of that industry talk, you know, because that's really not
right.
Industry,
yeah,
you know, it's a relief because I'm frankly not really interested in it.
But have you been, you know, contacted by, you know, cymbal companies, like having you as an endorser of them, or?
Yeah, but it was a well, let's just say it didn't work.
Yeah.
You know, I had ideas to, okay, I'll endorse your product and I'll do everything that you say in your contract. But I have something I'd like to do, which is you sponsor me to go in underprivileged neighborhoods and you donate product to that community.
That's a great idea.
And they're not interested.
Yeah.
So I don't need to name names, but it's pretty obvious. And so I really... same with drums. I remember Dennis Chambers, who was fantastic. Man, what a great human being.
Yeah.
Wow. We are so lucky that there's somebody in my lifetime, there's somebody like, so great like him on the planet. When we first met, you know, he was kind of shocked. I mean, you don't endorse, you're not with anybody, you know. And he set up this meeting so that I could meet somebody from Pearl. So it was really great. I'll always be forever thankful, you know, to Dennis for really supporting me and being so generous. You know. So I meet this guy from Pearl. We have lunch. It's a lunch date, right? First thing, he takes out a piece of paper and he says, "So what size stadiums do you play?" So I immediately, you know, we were at a fairly decent restaurant. We had just ordered food, and I just decided, I don't want to waste time here. I want to take advantage of every moment. So I told him, I said, "Look, let's just not waste time." I said, "I'm not an athlete. I'm really a musician, and I'm not going to really have what you. I don't play stadiums. I know what you're looking for, and I know Dennis set this up in hopes that, you know, I could do something, but I'm just not that material. And why don't we just have a great dinner or lunch? Why don't we just have a great lunch, enjoy the meal, and let's not worry about this endorsement deal, okay?"
Yeah.
And that was that.
Yeah.
And I felt like really good about it because I'm just not a company guy. I never been that kind of guy. Like Dennis, I mean, he grew up playing stadiums. I mean, he could move mountains. He's that kind of a player. He can get a whole, he can get 5,000 people up on their feet, you know. And he does it in an honest, he's honest. That's him.
Yeah.
He's not doing it so he can get an endorsement. That's Dennis, man. It's so great. It just so happens that lines up with what those guys look for. Yeah, but I always appreciated the fact that, you know, he...
Yeah, that's nice.
Yeah. Like, those guys only come around when you don't need them. Yeah, it's just part of it. It's not about music. I mean, I would have appreciated, at one point, I would have really appreciated to have some support, you know, but that, it didn't happen, and that's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, as far as endorsements go, when you're in real visible situations, they all come around wanting to offer you a deal, and it's not me.
Yeah.
And besides, I don't carry that shit around anyhow. I play everybody's stuff.
And yeah.
My take on equipment is very, a drum hasn't changed since they cut a tree down and hollowed out the inside of it and put a skin across it. I mean, that's part of what allows me to be the way I am, to just play any instrument. That's been my way of life, you know, and up to now it's worked, and it's made for some really enjoyable times on the road instead of wondering where my floor tom went in Chicago.
Yeah.
And where, you know,
traveling wondering. Gets so much easier. Yeah,
and when I'm on the road, it's really a job, because my job is to play the music for the people who come to listen to it the best I can. And man, I can't really do that stuff if I'm chasing around to repair a bass drum pedal or look for my exact type of snare drum, or, you know.
Like it says in the rider, you know.
Yeah, you know, very seldom they ever read those riders.
Yeah.
So, that whole issue is like, it's great to have great instruments, and it's really great to meet people who make them and who really care about them. There are some great manufacturers out there, but my main purpose is to use those to try and make the music happen, to let the music happen.
Yeah. You talked before about learning to read music and, you know, learning to read rhythm. Okay. How do you prepare when you play with somebody new, or also when you play with somebody you've played before with, but he sends you or she sends you music? How do you prepare to be ready for it on the gig?
It depends. Sometimes I just have to study the part, what they send me. I just have to study the roadmap and learn that. I try to get as familiar with it as I can. I don't have one of those photographic memories, but I try and memorize the sound. I'll go to a piano and try and bang out the chords and the bass motion, if there's that kind of harmony, if it's that kind of music. If it's not that kind of music, if there is no harmony involved, I try and learn the order of events that are taking place and the roadmap and the dynamic changes, the shifts and the changes in the music and where I need to be at a certain point in the piece. Yeah, I try and get as familiar with the shape of each piece of music as I can.
Hmm.
You know, sometimes it's notated really poorly, like maybe rhythmically written in a way that's really hard to decipher, or just physically, legibly, the handwriting is so bad that I have to sit and think, okay, what did he mean here? You know,
yeah.
Or call them up and talk to them about it. Yeah, that's what I do. And in case sometimes there is nothing to do except maybe be acquainted with the person, kind of listen to their music, what they do, what their aesthetics are, just to try and get familiar with what can I expect, what's their range of awareness that I'm going to have to deal with here.
Yeah. I told you when we met at the Loft in Cologne, I told you I studied with John Taylor.
Yeah,
and I'm my favorite record of John's, and I love all of them, but my favorite one is the one with you and Mark Johnson, Roslyn.
Oh, yeah.
And I think you guys really pulled something out of JT that anyone else could, you know, that nobody else could, you know, that nobody else could. Because John Taylor was always a guy who played differently than others, but you made him play even more differently, you know. And I wonder if you can share maybe a couple of memories of working with John, and also how he was as a band leader, and what the dynamic was in that trio. Yeah, any memories you'd like to share, really?
Well, first of all, he's just a wonderful human being. John was just a great guy to hang out with. He loved life. He loved people, to hang out with people. He loved to have a good time. It's great guy to be around. And that came through, he was in touch with that in his music. You know, he had a long relationship with Kenny Wheeler, and his music has a sound. I mean, not just on the piano, but his writing has a certain quality to it.
Yeah.
And also he played the piano. He had a sound.
Yeah.
He didn't just have fast fingers or licks that he could pull off. I mean, he had a really nice sound.
Yeah.
It was like he had the chords and the harmonies dictated, but in terms of the sonic atmosphere and the feeling, he left that up to me, which is, I mean, to me, that's what I grew up thinking. I grew up learning that was one of the functions of being a drum set player, is that's part of your job, is you get to interpret all of this information that the other people need to really adhere by.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have to play B minor 7 flat 5. They do. But I get to interpret how that feels by being a part of a team.
Mm.
And, you know, he would have things on the music like a waltz or open feeling or something. And then also, I think John comes from a tradition, you know, that's quite different. He's British, and different cultures have different approaches. So I think he was more involved in just in terms of feels and phrasings. He was more involved with like straight eighth note type musics or that kind of phrasing. You know, I grew up, I came from, you know, I listened to all those Oscar Peterson records and, you know, and to a lot of people that can be very corny. But John, I mean, like for instance, I play a lot of blues, like that shuffle, that feeling, like just a nasty, I love that feel. I've heard it since I was a kid. I've always loved the way it made me feel. I'd love to be a part of it. I play with a lot of people who play blues most of the night. And I don't think that was really part of his background. But that's the thing that's cool about people. You know, when people come and meet and they leave all of the ego shit at the front door, that's what Abercrombie was a total master of, by the way. But you enter the room, let's say, and you're open. So he was open to, like, if Mark and I would get into a feel that was, like, really kind of, you know, obviously in, shuffle-like or had that feeling, I think he thought he would kind of chuckle, and then he would kind of actually have fun at toying with that and
yeah,
digging into that from his perspective.
Yeah.
And knowing that I'm not comparing it to anybody I ever played with that was all about that or that only spent their life playing blues or phrasing in that way. I thought sometimes the combination creates something special.
Yeah.
And I think all of us were of that spirit. He had things for us that took us into places like, well, I've never done this, but you know, here's my version of it. And I would kind of do something and kind of laugh at myself. You know, we just share that kind of spirit. And I think maybe that's what you hear. And you know, I wasn't trying to necessarily please him. And I don't think he was trying to please us. I mean, we were working for him. And of course, the object is to make him sound as good as he possibly can sound.
Mm.
But I think we share that with each other. It's not a one-way street.
Yeah.
John was that kind of guy where it was definitely not a one-way street. Most people are. You just make them sound good. Thank you very much. Here's your fee.
Yeah.
John was, he's fantastic. He was very open, and he, I think maybe he felt that we weren't timid in trying to do what he would want us to do. We were just ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And we all kind of had a silent understanding that, man, we're going to try and make, let's make some music here.
Yeah.
And I think that's what you hear. I think a lot of times in situations when you hear one person like established and you hear other people who are maybe either students or not established, you kind of, what you're hearing is them trying to find their way and very afraid to do something. You're trying to second guess what they might want to hear.
Mm.
So you play like the person that they just played with on the recording.
Yeah.
You know, which is the worst possible thing you can do.
Mm-hmm. Very true.
Yeah. So that's what I remember about that part of what you said about JT. You know?
Yeah.
And he was just a wonderful, a great musician. God, his music was so wonderful.
Yeah.
And very special player and not afraid, just not afraid to go places. Not afraid. He's not afraid to leave space. He's not afraid to share. He just listened. And I think that was, when you're around people that do that, you can't technically agree on that. It's just something you either do or you don't. And yeah, I think probably that's what you heard.
Yeah. Beautiful. What do you do if you don't feel inspired? What do you do if you also maybe feel self-doubt, you know, getting out of a situation where you kind of maybe second guess what you're doing too much? How do you get out of it?
In the late 70s, while I was living in LA, I worked with this guy named Lenny Bro, incredible legend. And I had the incredible good fortune to meet him, and he lived with me for a very short period, and we worked together every week for a while at this club called Dante's and other little clubs around LA. And I recorded every note of every gig I ever played and listened back to it afterward, and the next day listened back, and you know. And I started hearing like these awful nights. And I hated the way I was playing. And then what I hated even worse was how I sounded when I tried to make it better. That was. And then I learned when you're having what you perceive as a bad night, whether it's you're depressed or you could be exhausted, you could be playing music you don't really want to be playing. You could be with people you don't really want to be with, or all of those things at once.
No.
It's just not happening on the instrument. It's just not there. I learned very slowly to just, again, be aware that, oh, this is one of those nights, and I really suck. You know, like that's the feeling that's going through my head.
Yeah.
So I pay attention, I'm aware of that, but I add to that, I learned to add this one thing that really has helped me, that's an interesting feeling.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then I get, you know, it's just a split second, like, boom. And then it's not even a second. It's like it comes through my mind like, boy, that sucks. This is not going well at all. It's like, oh, it's one of those nights. Yeah, that's what it feels like. Oh, that's an interesting feeling. And then, well, back to playing.
Yeah.
And you just let it happen. Because what happens, see, when you start obsessing about it, it's all about you. It becomes all about you. And man, we got too much of that already.
Mm-hmm.
Especially now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's all about everybody's posturing, like, yeah, it's about the music, but it's really about them.
Mm.
And nobody wants to hear that, you know, like, oh man, I couldn't get that. I missed this, I missed that. You know, a lot of times if you're just playing the music, what you perceive as being a horrible night, that's your perception. Somebody else might think it's the best shit they ever heard.
Yeah.
And so when they come up to you and say, wow, I really dug that, why insult their intelligence? Let them have a good time.
Mm-hmm.
Just thank you. And, you know, you can hang on to that.
to the hate.
Well, not hang on to the self-hate, but just say, wow, that sure felt shitty to me.
Yeah.
But, oh, well, that's what that was.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's the way it was that night. And I learned that very slowly by listening to myself on those gigs. And like I said, I thought, man, this night, man, it just wasn't happening. And then listening to the next set from that same night, and boy, that really wasn't happening. And I remember trying to make it happen. I could hear every instance where I tried, and it was awful. And I said, wow, I do not want to go there. And so it's just a long process. And then also, I think by hearing people play on any level, just hearing all the stars play and hearing your local musician play at a bar where nobody's listening and he's playing stupid, you know, music because that's his gig. Some nights are better than others for that person too.
You know? Yeah.
Hearing these great people have bad nights, that's a real education.
That's a big lesson, yeah.
Because when you hear the records, you know, you hear Miles Davis and like, wow. Man, everything was just perfect. And they just went in the studio and did that. Well, maybe they didn't just go in the studio and hit it first take. Maybe they took 15 stabs at it, like Freedom Jazz Dance.
True, yeah.
Which is now available, you know, that process is now available to get a look at what went into that. Or hear great musicians in concert and where, gee, it's not that great.
Yeah.
I mean, it's on a high level, but it's that special thing. It's special. It doesn't happen every time somebody plays. And I think it's important. It was for me to hear musicians play that were on that level that I idolized and then realized that, wow, you know, that was so-and-so playing. And, you know, it didn't sound that great. I was listening to maybe a moment where everything was happening. And it was captured on record. And those moments are really precious. If you really follow a God, and they have shitty days too.
Yeah.
And I really learned so much from that.
Yeah.
I think it's important to play with all kinds of levels, to put yourself, you know, in the position of playing with people who know a hell of a lot more than you do.
Oh, yeah.
I think it's important to play with people who haven't been on the planet half as long as you have.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's important to play with people who are your peers. All of that, because there's an incredible amount to be learned from being the most experienced one, and you're surrounded by people who don't have a clue. Okay. They can't play, let's say,
mm-hmm.
but what that does to you're not going to get your rocks off playing, but what you could do is learn how to be patient.
True.
And learn to recognize, wow, they want this, or they don't want it.
Yeah.
And figure out that and be interested in trying to help them along. You have the experience, they don't. How can you help them? Because at some point somebody helped me.
Yeah, and you remember those moments, right? I mean,
yeah, it's very important moments.
Very clearly, yeah.
And so I think there's an art and a real skill at being in that position where you know the answer, but do you have enough balls to just shut the fuck up and let them come up with the answer and pay attention to them while they're doing it? That's hard.
That's
and
hard, see that, yeah.
That's listening. That's listening. If you can do that, man, those are the kind of musicians I like to play with.
Mm.